That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. He's just like, he's
boring enough
to go,
he's damaged enough.
Yeah. I'm on Periscope.
Oh, no, it's definitely like he's trying, like, one day I'll get him.
But right now, me, I have to go.
Oh, did we ever figure out the singing thing?
So that's the part of right now.
Got it. Perfect.
If you watch the broadcast, it's mostly...
Literally,
yeah. Oh, really? There's all of these turds in the factory. Uh-huh. There. It's
crazy.
I've never watched...
My fun is, thanks for your buck, I didn't watch this racing
I definitely watched 5-Minute One, because they're both
really good sports series.
Sure.
They're doing it differently this year than last year.
I think one time I watched for, like, 5 minutes,
Saturday was...
Is this the pre-show?
Yes.
Or are we streaming right now?
Hi, Periscope.
Should we be talking about something other than James Gunn's porn career?
Than James Gunn's porn predilections? Anyway, well, a big shout out to James Gunn and
big
the porn he watches.
He's a big fan. I'm not.
Big fan. He hates him.
Totally.
Big. There's a big feud brewing.
Super was not.
Yeah. There. Yeah. Well,
Romeo and Juliet.
Slither was...
It had Nathan Fillion in it. Slither is good.
I don't know.
Yeah. Wait, you don't like Super?
No, I have a lot of problems with Super. Like, I have action real. Yeah.
It's too mean-spirited to enjoy it.
It is pretty mean.
It hates you too much to love it.
But who's the you in that movie?
I liked Ellen Page in that film, and I got connected to her character, and they murdered her so callously. Off-screen. That I could not recover.
And she also did enough in that movie to at least justify her being put in danger. Right? Like,
not
her, the tone of the movie spirited person.
Yeah, but it's Ellen Page.
You want to see what it sounds like over in the speaker with the loudspeaker?
I mean, it was like against Tycho.
Can you name another movie where Ellen Page dies?
Does Beyond Two Souls count?
No, I said a film, not a garbage.
Not a garbage.
Not a trash bag for
garbage people.
The first thing
I'm gonna get emails about this, aren't I?
Everybody.
That's it.
I'm like, let me check my phone real quick.
Hi, everybody. Okay, so we're gonna go dark now, but we'll come back right before the show starts. Travis is holding the phone. Thank you, Travis. We will see you at 7 o'clock Central, 8 o'clock Eastern. That is 5 o'clock Pacific. And then if that, it should be 1 o'clock GMT. I don't know. Go to sleep. Okay. We'll see you right here, there, then, in a bit. All right. Bye, guys.
We're using for communication, though, and things all right. From the whoever's simulcast.
Say again?
The person that's simulcasting, how do we know everything's okay on their end?
We'll have to trust.
Great. Yeah. That sounds good.
No, if something fucks up, you'll have your local copy. Yeah, that's the most important thing. Thank you so much. If you need anything, give me a high sign, and I'll come back.
Yeah.
Periscope? Periscope?
I don't care. Oh, dashboard. I'll put this live on Twitch.
I think they're doing like a
Oh, you're right. They are. Yeah, never mind. I wasn't going to, really. I was just logging into my own. So, last year there was a bonfire. Are we doing anything like that? Or? No, I don't. One was a beat. Oh, okay. That was the thing that was confusing me the last time.
You went to the DKT bonfire?
No. I just heard rumors.
Oh, I was just saying, I was like, I would have remembered.
No, the bonfire was a DKT TwitchCon. That was it.
Yes. And then I threw a prom.
Okay, yeah.
And then I did a beer prom.
Well, I mean, like, I've got 5 gallons of beer in my truck, so
we're doing hotel parties this time.
Yeah, I just need there to be a party that I can bring in.
We'll do parties, and you can get there.
Well, yeah, I'm playing the super low theme, super disco. Wherever the fucking party goes, leave it that way. Whoever Dino Time wants, we can do it.
We meet up for
Tomorrow is Friday. They're right here.
Excuse me, Travis.
Ow!
Yep.
Why'd that shirt with the new
one? Hi, I'm Brian Brushwood.
I get stage fright for the first time.
This has never happened before.
Let me show you my face on that's my
chair. I think you're over here. Hey. Oh, hello. Hi, I didn't see you there. Hey, how many people are seeing that attack for the first time ever? All right, please, good. Everyone else has a couple of people lying. I can see their liar hands. All right.
Are we good? Okay. All right, hey.
Oh. Hey, can we turn off sports?
I get the volume.
Yeah, that's the channel.
Live,
I meant to say that before we started. And then I forgot.
Oh, look at that. Oh, so weird. Ladies and gentlemen, the best bartender on the planet, Selena!
Give Selena $1 million.
Yay!
Collectively. Not one of you.
Wait, taller than me.
I am so shocked you gave me the tall seat.
I didn't.
Like, that is the biggest upset of the evening.
I was assigned. Hey, Katrina, can we trade seats?
No, Brian.
No, I mean, not that you would be on stage, but that I would be
yeah, can you
taller.
Co-host the show? Do you just want to switch? You can just switch seats. Go.
Okay, yes. Totally.
Oh, my God.
Assist.
Twist your arm.
All right.
Oh, that's what you said.
Fuck yeah.
Wow, I did.
All right.
Okay.
All right. Do you want to set this up?
No, okay. All right, so tell everyone about the Will Harris thing.
So, how many people, listeners to the show, know who Will Harris is?
Was it GQ's most eligible bachelors or something?
It was some
Condé Nast Cup publication.
Shocking. So he's a great friend, of course, to the show, and a brilliant human being, and he decided to write down our poor synopsis of of a made up. Okay, so if you guys watched last week's episode, we played a game where we had to describe Oscar movies we hadn't seen, and one of them was Hell or High Water. So we decided it was the story of a mattress salesman named Hell or High Water, and we made up a really dumb story, which sounds dumb out of our mouths while we're saying it. But when somebody writes it down,
yeah,
and then feeds it back to you by an audio file recorded in the style of a Rick and Morty alternate universe trailer, it was a surreal moment.
So this is a British person doing an impression of Justin Roiland improvising a movie using the words that we were using to improvise a movie.
The exact words.
So here we go. This is Hell or High Water.
He's a mattress salesman in Peoria. A man has he got it raw. His wife is just cheating on him. Cheating on him all the time, and she's just like, "Hello, I'm fucking everybody in this town." And he goes, "Hey man, I'm Hella Highwater. You don't talk to me that way, dame." And then he just like sits down. He sits down and. And cries, and that's pretty much the movie. But at the end, though, there's the big ending where he sells the mattress, but it's a big celebrity cameo from Johnny Depp, but he's doing a voice. I'm Johnny Depp, and I'd like to buy a mattress now. Oh, I don't know, Rick. It feels like movies in this dimension kind of have more of an improvisational feel. You know what I mean?
All right. The adorable Will Harris, ladies and gentlemen.
The adorable.
So when you played that for me and went through three layers, you said, "Hey, man."
Well, remember when he just texted it to me today?
Right.
He just was like, "Hey, do you watch Rick and Morty?" And I'm like, "Sure." And then he just texted me a sound file.
Well, and so he's like, he said, "I hear Will Harris sent this to me," and he starts playing it, and I hear it. I'm like, "Oh, he's doing an impression of Rick and Morty." And I'm like, "But this is a dumb bit." And then that realization that those are our words reflected through the funhouse mirror of the Brito himself. All right, I'm getting the high side. I think it's time to start the show. Is that right?
All right,
here we go. Are you guys ready to start the show?
You ready?
Holy shit, beautiful people live from PAX South or nearby. It's that. Bringing you the best of the worst of the internet ever since anyone cared. Hey, I'm Brian Brushwood. Nobody cares. And Justin Harvey Young. Still nobody cares.
Still nobody.
Yeah, see, we're at this mushy middle. I mean, number one, it's a miracle that this happened, considering that we invested 20 minutes in a taco. But number two, the fact, like, we got a great turnout here for what we expected. We just wanted to record live and wanted one person, and instead we got 20.
Yeah. Woo! No, it's great. Well, thank you all for coming. Man, it's a good thing that horse shit is infinite and that we can keep making more of it, because we literally did a show like 48 hours ago and now we are here. But you want to know what? We are going to get through this thanks to a lot of very talented people.
At audible.com.
Yes.
Oh, no, sorry.
Well, did you want to go over some of the stuff that we were talking about today?
Yeah.
What did you want to talk about?
Hold on. There's. I wrote it down because I didn't want
to... You didn't want to forget it. This is very important, folks. We know that
all
we
right.
need to make sure that we're bringing it here.
I wrote these things down. I wrote down Jeep, which I think was a reference to us driving down in the Jeep and me picking you up in the Jeep and you being angry that when I picked you up at the airport in the Jeep, I wasn't blasting Ba Wa Ba. Instead, I just turned on the 90s station and turned it to whatever.
Well, yeah. Like, he's like, "Oh, I was trying to figure out what the perfect song would be to pick you up in the Jeep in." And I'm like, "Do you not know how to spell Ba Wa Ba?"
But the real thing was I chickened out. Like, I'm sitting there and it's short and I'm just like, I can't.
Like, I can do it for 30 seconds and then peel out and be like, so long, fuckos!
I know.
But I can't do it in that slow grind of that meatpacking conveyor belt of just, like, I can't stop and start for 15 goddamn minutes as my car creeps along blasting bomb into bomb, and I have to make eye contact with every cop reject who's running on the TSA and telling me to blow forward. Blow forward?
I really wanted you to be in the cell phone lot of the Austin International Airport, and you start playing Ba with the Ba, and then you're like halfway there when it ends, and you have to make the uncomfortable decision where it's just like repeat.
Alright, I also wrote down, sideburns, because I got a haircut while you were on DTNS today, mm-hmm. and getting a haircut in another city is a weird thing, because I needed it very badly, so I just opened it, found the nearest one, looked at Yelp, it was 5 stars, went in, hipster as hell, they got a bar, they immediately sat me down, and they're like, you want a shot? They open up a
fridge.
So
do you
think
that they offer everybody a shot? Or just looked at you in the face and they're like, this dude will take free liquor and it doesn't matter what it is.
I mean, if they did, they also had a time machine and set everything up in advance, because I walked in and he opened up a mini fridge and I had a choice between a shot of Jameson, a shot of Crown Royal, a Coronita, the tiny Corona bottles, who just said, aw, and a Bud Light.
But they all had Brian's name on it.
So which of those four do you think I picked for my haircut? Because the answer wasn't no, obviously.
Okay, I think I really want you to get
there's
the
a murmur in the crowd.
Yeah, everybody's discussing. I think it's the shot of Jamie.
No, see, that would say I am a hardcore alcoholic. Instead, I wanted a beer, but I'm like, man, you won't get a Bud Light in a place like this, so I took the Coronita. And so I sat there with a Coronita.
Go to the pay window, everybody who had Coronita, now collecting.
And so I told them, and this, okay, here's the question I have for you. Because, do the haircut, and it's like, I never know how to describe how I want my haircut. So I always open up, I Google my name.
You son of a bitch. You son of a bitch. I'm the first result. Just breaking the ice.
Well, and so the problem is I don't want what my last haircut looked like. I want the way it looked when I was on Foolus. And so. So anyway, I show up my Twitter avatar, and I'm trying. This is as cool as I'm able to play. I'm like something like this. Less is more, because I. And then I realized I painted myself in a corner because I have to say, because I have a shoot. And I have this shoot thing. And just get started. And by the way, he did the smartest move I've ever seen of any barber ever. He shut you
up with a Coronita.
He started cutting my hair and then turned the chair around away from the mirror. I've never done that. Have you ever experienced that where they cut your entire hair and didn't let you see how it was going?
I don't know. Yeah. I don't know the magic of thing? I don't know the magic of barbers. Like, I don't know if they would, like, and now you need to walk outside. Like, I would. Like, they can just tell me what to do and I'll do it.
Well, and so I found myself, anyway, I was in that awkward position where it's like, I was like, all right, I'm going to own this. So it's like I told them all about, you know, doing the stage show and what we're up to next week and stuff. And then he's like, wait, what's that? And
you run down your entire resume?
Well, there's a long time when he keeps asking you, well, what do you mean? My shoot.
Yeah.
Magic? What kind of magic?
So I started working at Dell, and my wife gave me 1 year to make magic a career.
God damn it. Alright, so at any rate, so here's the awkward part, and this is the secret. He gave a fine haircut, but they always ask, how do you want your sideburns? And of course, I wear the perpetual, 20-minute scruff that the grown-ups are able to grow. And so I'm like, well, I always say, like, it doesn't matter. I mean, it's going to eventually become this beard thing or whatever, right? And yeah. He's like, so rounded, square? I'm like, I don't know, blended, I guess? He's like, okay. And I get the haircut and everything's great, and I go home, or I go to your place, pick you up or whatever. It is not until, like, I go to the bathroom like an hour ago that I look in the mirror and realize when shaping my sideburns, he shaved underneath the sideburns, so I have one of those, I'm shaved and my beard starts below my cheek things.
No, yeah. No, not right now. For only audio listeners, there would be a little evil Knievel that would have to make the jump from his high beard
down to his beard.
I've never worn
that's the little Snake River Canyon on Brian's next to his ear hole.
I'm very uncomfortable with it. That's my whole point, is that it feels very awkward and I can't wait until
next week. Hold on, Brian. What's more uncomfortable? If I, like, just rub it?
No, that's actually pretty good.
Is that good?
We ran into old ladies. On the way in, Bryce and I went and grabbed the stuff.
Yeah.
So we walk all the way over to the parking lot.
Before you even tell the story, all I imagine is just, like, you know, you pull up and all of a sudden, like, it's a 1980s beer commercial. It's just like a Camaro pulls up with a bunch of old ladies in it.
I just pulled down my sunglasses.
It's just a polka version of Van Halen's Beautiful Girls.
So, okay.
It's funnier if you think about it.
I went over and got this. We got the stuff, and so we're lugging all this crap, and it's very clearly sound equipment in the backpack and all that stuff. And so we get into the elevator, we're only going down one floor, and then there's like this one lady who walks up and then stops because she sees us with gear. And Bryce is like, oh, no, there's room, come on in. And she goes, well, I have a friend. And she goes, that's fine. And then she gets in, she's like, well, there's actually a few of us. So we're like, oh, and so we squeeze into the back. Yeah. And so, like, four adorable old ladies get in, and all of them, you know, it's like you get, it's the four Golden Girls, right? So picture, like, one's got the spiky hair, like, I don't give a fuck anymore. One's got the wacky hat.
Jesus!
No. Like, but at any rate, so they walk in, and we're friendly, and they're friendly, and they're like, oh, so, what did she say? She said, are you with the band, or are you the band? And so, faced with Sophie's Choice, I say, oh, actually, we do a comedy show. Actually, it's Bryce who outed us. He goes, we do a...
I said yes.
He said yes.
Basically, we're looking at every road that leads to explaining how famous you are. There's just a million ways to get to explaining that you're a very big deal.
Well, okay, so there's this moment.
Wow!
They said, are you with the, are you the band? And then Bryce goes, yes, we're the band. And then I'm like, oh, I mean, actually, it's a comedy show. And then I realize what I've done. And she turns and she goes, oh, tell me a joke. And the doors are closed, and we're now trapped for that 15 seconds. And I realize, like, oh shit,
have to tell a joke now?
Yes, exactly. And do I even know a joke? And so, like, I just tell the truth, and I'm like, we just pretty much say poop over and over. And then they all laugh, and then the door opens, and then I say out loud, I guess that was a joke. Because it made them laugh. So anyway, all ladies, I said poop too.
You said poop over and over again. All right. And there we go.
We made up a song about the Riverwalk.
You want to we're not going to talk about the song. Come up to me after the show.
You want to talk about Maggie Smith's butthole?
Oh, so you have, your butthole is Maggie Smith.
It is?
But we have to talk about that with our guests. Ladies and gentlemen, let's go ahead and welcome on right now. You know them from, of course, Movies with Mikey and the brand newly minted co-host of the Star Wars show, Mikey Newman and Anthony Carpone!
What's up, San Antonio? I've been here for 2 hours and my skin's dry as fuck already.
I'm very normal. Just a normal boy.
Skin is flaking like perfectly cooked fish sticks.
Yeah, okay.
Are you ready for this?
Yeah!
You're at a 9 and I love it.
Dude,
I love it.
This is like a 6.5.
Hey, Anthony, real quick, I assume there's one person in our whole audience who doesn't know what you do with the Star Wars show. Can you real quick?
Because it just happened
sure.
5 minutes ago.
Well, it's got a really complicated title, so people probably can't figure out the context.
Yeah.
It is a show about Star Wars.
Yeah.
But it's actually the official Lucasfilm show about Star Wars. We host it from the Lucasfilm compound in San Francisco.
Dude.
And it's all the newest Star Wars news, interviews.
Dude.
I'm a very big deal, sir. I'm a very big
deal. Just wait until you get your next haircut. That's the time that you can really blow it up.
The guy's cutting my hair. He's like, have you ever seen Star Wars?
I'm sorry. Did you just make
I'm tangentially related to it.
Did you just make a joke about Anthony's haircut? Because the entire audience is like, no, they have the exact same fucking hair across the board.
Yeah, we're
it's
tight.
Really
only the difference
no, it's
is
a spectrum.
I
we're
cut
like
my
going
own
spectrum
hair.
Of like haircut.
Hey, so seriously, do you run into Chewbacca at work?
We have Chopper. We have the actual like droid. We have
oh
Chopper
my God.
At work. We got a mouse droid at work, a functioning mouse droid.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have 3PO at work, but it doesn't work unless Anthony Daniels. Actually
so anyway, I also work at
also
Star Wars.
Mikey.
I actually am Chewbacca. Hello.
There are three YouTube channels that I can get my wife to watch with me.
That's
and
good
one of
noise,
them
right?
is Chainsaw Suit because
yeah.
she loves movies
Woo.
With Mikey.
Yeah. The next movie to Mikey is just gonna be like just over and over.
Damn it, somebody
oh, and
this.
Shots. And twins.
All right, so Captain Morgan, it is. I assume.
No, Baker's Mark.
Oh, geez, that no.
It's actually Captain John.
By the way, that was handed to us by the Patreon saint himself, Time Jumper.
Well, hey guys, thank you so much for coming on the show here tonight.
Of course, thank you for having us.
You've done.
I'm just sitting right in front of this.
Yeah,
fucking
that was
just
probably.
It's just feedback forever.
Tilt that.
Just forever.
That way. Yeah.
How long is this cord?
There we go.
Yeah. What if I went over here?
Just go over there.
What
yeah.
if I went over here?
That's the way to go.
There we go. Hey, so real quick, you this is my first.
Just real quick.
Tangential
just real quick.
Number one, you know that he's going on a shoot.
Damn it. Okay, no, in all seriousness, I've never been to PAX South, and I won't be able to go to PAX South. This is the closest I'll ever get to PAX South. You did PAX South before. You're doing it
yes.
at PAX South for the first time, right?
No, this is my third one.
Oh,
I am the OG here. Let's.
Yeah, Mikey's not local, but you're close.
Dallas, yeah.
Yeah.
5
I don't know how a Texas works.
It just keeps going as it turns out.
Just imagine.
You may be farther away from San Antonio than I am. I don't understand geography or time.
He's pretty much a longer, almost as long a drive as yours would be to commute to work.
No, it makes sense. Don't worry. Look it up on Google Maps. These are all the best jokes.
Get out of whiteboard.
Yeah. They were good attempts at jokes. I give you guys the effort for trying.
All right.
Wow!
Okay, but hold on. I thought this was your first movies with Mikey as a panel. That's not
no,
the case.
Yes, that is true. I'm doing the first live movies with Mikey Saturday, 6:30 at Falcon Theater.
Who's going to be there for that?
That like stuff. That's cool.
Yeah.
That's new.
And so how do you take that? Because the Movies with Mikey experience is very tight and chopped and edited together.
So here's why I'm the dumbest person alive. I actually am doing that live. I built a presentation that I will run through while talking, and I'm editing it in real time.
Yeah, it's just gonna be him like slowly scrubbing to the exact point in which
it's a lot simpler than that, but yeah. I put together a presentation that I talk over and
have you revealed what movie you're reviewing?
No, so that was the thing. I thought it would be really funny if I did an episode of Movies with Mikey about Movies with Mikey.
About how famous you are.
Yeah, about how famous I am. Brian Brushwood, star of Discovery Channel and other things.
No, I thought it would be funny to do an ironic dissection of the show, and what I found out was...
Are you going
to
make us cry at the end for how good your show is?
Maybe. I did actually have some realizations of my own about my own show, and I was like, oh shit, I didn't know why I was doing that, and now I do know... And it was very weird.
You tricked yourself into self-reflection for once.
I movies with Mikey myself. And I was like, is that what that feels like? I don't like it. I'm not good at that.
I mean, I wonder what it would be like if you were Mystery Science Theatering your own life as it happened.
I feel like Joel Hodgson does that. I would like it if this forever changed you, and now you were just like, the show was different, you were different, you had different hair.
Yeah,
like,
I'm no longer funny, I only eat lizards.
Yeah, it's mostly a lizard-based diet.
It's the South lizard diet.
Yeah, you only have to catch them free-range, though, or else it doesn't count. No store-bought lizards.
My bar is Central Market lizards and up.
which
does include Market Street. I got you, baby birds. You can get lizards from there. It's fine.
All right. So the moment we did not ask him to do this, but basically we put out the bat signal for all our favorite people at PAX, and we're like, hey, you're awesome people. We're going to do a night attack, and we know it'll be easy if awesome friends show up. And four of them said, three said yes, one said no. And two showed up, so that's not bad.
That is very good.
Can I tell you, I had so Mikey and I have only ever communicated via DM.
This is also the first time we've ever met.
We have only communicated via DM, and we've hung out like a million times, but I didn't recognize his number, and so what happened is like, you were, hey, we're gonna do a live night attack, and the number I didn't recognize goes, oh, can I put together a quiz? I was like, oh, that's Mikey's number! Now.
You know the worst part of this story? I actually saved your number in my phone, and I think you did not save my number in your phone.
Wow! Mikey's number, and so I just DM you.
I think Star Wars changes a man.
Yeah. Very important now. Very important.
So Mikey made a quiz, and normally we play this as a two-player operation, but
yes,
I think we could do three teams, and we'll just rotate who has to go first.
What would make my night easier if someone could keep score? Because I don't want
to... How about the internet?
Can I give you a pen and a pad?
Yeah, all right. Who's going to be on our...
I brought a journal.
Yeah, there we go.
Where the pen is, I already wrote everybody's names down. You'll notice the jury is listed as Jummy, because that's my favorite thing in the world.
All right.
This is a 10-question quiz.
Oh, by the way, you're welcome to walk across. This is not important.
Yeah, we're really good. All right, so for audio listeners, we are literally blocking...
Could you just wait for like 27 to 35 minutes? Just hold on. We're almost done.
I like that you gave a white band 27 to 35. So on Night Attack, I often quiz these two dumbos with really irrelevant dumb shit. And I thought, what better way to go through the weekend than to put together the most diabolical quiz ever?
Which, by the way, for the first time, I believe, on the show, you pre-tested to get feedback.
I did. I pre-tested it on my friend, who knows me very well, and metagamed it. He only got 5 out of 10.
So that's the baseline.
And he had a freebie. So to jump into this, the title of this quiz is Bad 1980s Action Movies and the User Submitted IMDb Descriptions That Explain Their Plot.
How fucking dare you?
That explain their plot or don't. So what I've done, just to explain it, I took the most low-budget, horrible 1980s action movies, grabbed their titles, found their IMDb reviews and plot synopses from crowdsourcing, which is very bad, and they cannot write words or grammar,
right?
And then I wrote fake ones in, utilizing their terrible grammar,
fake ones in.
And now you must all guess if the thing I'm talking about is real or fake.
All right,
my lovely assistant will be keeping score. What's right. your name, by the way? Sorry.
Tess.
Yeah. will be getting scored.
Thank you, Tess.
I'm
Let's
gonna...
all at once. Here we go. On three. One, two, three.
Thank you, Tess.
Thank you, Auntie Dom.
All right. So,
all right. Wait, before we get into this, because Carboni, like, just his world fell from his face as soon as this topic was mentioned. Do you feel confident about guessing the veracity of these 1980s movies?
So, am I guessing that the movie is real? Am I guessing that the review is real?
There's
two situations. Either the movie is real, and this is the actual IMDb synopsis as submitted by the IMDb community. Or this is all horseshit. So basically,
or Mikey,
okay,
so it's
like,
all gonna be true.
Or it's all true or all fake.
Gotcha.
But luckily I gotta write.
I feel okay about it.
You won't in about.
I'm sure I won't. I have a really inflated sense of self. So I feel pretty good about everything.
No.
Yeah.
That's how you know you got a mark.
He
comes marching in. I can't be fooled.
All right,
take it away.
Let's go. So the way we're going to do this is going to start with Jummy. It's going to go around to Anthony on the first question, then it'll start with Brian,
Roger.
Go back around to Jummy, and so on and so forth.
Roger.
All right. Jury, you are first.
Let's go.
Here is the title and description as described by IMDb. Is this a real or fake movie from the 1980s? Here we go.
All right.
The name of the movie is Hell Comes to Frogtown. And the synopsis, Hell is the name of the hero of the story. He's a prisoner of the woman who now runs the USA after a nuclear/biological war. Results of the war are the mutants have evolved and the human race is in danger of extinction because of infertility. Hell is given the task of helping in the rescue of a group of fertile women from the harem of the mutant leader and parenthetically listed after the mutant leader resembling a frog is in parentheses. So is that a real 1980s B action film, Jimmy, or is that a fake?
Well, you did it this time, Mikey.
You have no idea how bad this gets.
Well, I'm glad our baseline is total incoherence. I am going to say that is a real.
Brian Rushwood.
All right. I am thinking that the odds that this is a real movie and the odds that we made up a movie called Hell or High Water are extraordinarily low.
We didn't make up the fact that there's a movie called Hell or High Water.
Right,
no, that's still nominated for actual Academy Award Troglodytes.
Okay, all right,
but didn't watch it or know what it was.
No. Okay,
but all right.
But we made it a character named Heller. Hell. So I'm gonna
Heller.
I'm gonna say that's gotta be.
All right, we got a real or a fake.
It's real. I've seen Hell Comes to Frogtown.
Really?
Yeah. Because they would show it on USA and Cinemax, and there's a part with sexy ladies dancing, and I was like 10 years old. I've seen the original Frogtown and Hell Comes
Anthony
to Frogtown.
Anthony Carboni called it. That is 1 point to Jummy and 1 point to the in your pants. Like, we just started.
Everybody at the door, make sure to let everybody know that they're welcome to just cross in front of us.
Yeah, come on in.
Doesn't matter.
All right,
go for it.
What if we give them, like, theme music? Like, boop, boop, doop, 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 as they walk. Okay, number two.
That's a great song.
Number two.
In fact, that's the official theme song. We gesture for them to go across, and then all of us just
so anybody
together
listening
go,
at home, boop, 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 boop.
Is that just the power of
it?
It's like a copyright free off.
No, that's pretty exactly it.
Yeah.
No, you got it. It's
that's
a,
basically
a,
like they
it's
pull
it's
out
a, it's in a minor key.
Yeah, that's
minor
like
key.
Minor key. Yeah. Yeah.
All right, number
we're
two.
We're more proud of the Power Rangers theme song than the new Power Rangers movie that apparently is like, you know, going to be as serious as.
Yeah, let's get back on topic here, guys.
All right,
number two, starting.
And the topic is the use of Kanye West's power in the trailer for reboots of 90s
preteen television shows.
Sure.
Because I can talk a lot about that.
All right. We're going to start with Brian on this one. Number
so
two.
Off topic.
Is this a real 1980s shitty action movie or not?
All right.
The title is 2156. What would you not pay for in without the price of freedom?
What?
If Duke Alex knows, then people are about to die. The year is 2156. Yeah, you said that already, movie. Everyone is about to die. Can Duke Alex... excuse me. Can Duke Alex play Russian roulette with the neon cops, or will he lose it all? Brian Brushwood.
My favorite part about this is that if Mikey gets too drunk, it doesn't matter.
Can I get confirmation? The title is just 2156?
The title is just the year 2156.
All right, gotcha. which year does this take place in?
2156.
Okay. I'm going to say this is real. It's too bad. It's too...
Yeah. What is that real? We're moving on.
Gotcha.
Oh, no!
I'm saying false.
Yo, no!
You're more dumb. Go.
I am going to say. So normally, I just have to look at your Skype window. I'm going to look into your cold, dead eyes. That's false.
It is false?
Yeah!
All right.
Oh, I'm feeling good now. I got the votes right back.
I am so glad Chris Stroudman showed up.
I used to listen to a lot of Chainsaw Super podcasts, and I know.
Because.
The first couple of these are all about a false sense of security.
Nope. Oh, yeah. Wrong. Number three
is Ted Games,
which starts with Anthony Carboni.
Yeah.
And listen to the whole thing before you react.
All right.
The title of the film is Blade Crammer.
Sorry, hold on. Blade Crammer.
Blade all one
Crammer.
Word.
Blade Crammer.
Blade Crammer.
So lowercase c. Lowercase c.
Is it about Edgar Blade Crammer?
Excuse me. The synopsis is as follows.
It's about a shipwright in the 1800s. Edgar
yeah.
Blade Crammer.
Yep. I will say, laugh now and listen, because the year is 20 years later.
Oh, after 2166.
The Earth, excuse me, it's very serious.
So it's 2176.
The Earth is run by corporations who only crave oil. This satirical look at sci-fi movies like Voyagers or Blade Runner will have you rolling in the aisles begging for more.
Is that
Blade Crammer?
Blade Crammer.
Blade Crammers.
You started with me?
God, help us.
Blade Crammer is
wait,
false.
Wait. Didn't you just go first?
No.
You just did.
Okay,
he just went. He's a fake.
He's S or a Z in Blade Crammers.
Oh, I thought it was singular.
It's S. It's just Blade Crammers, like spelled like
it's just okay. Blade Crammer. Singular Blade Crammer.
Sir, no. Blade Crammers.
Blade Crammers. No Z. S. Okay, got you.
How many exclamation points?
None. How many enemies? I'm gonna say that's also false.
I'm gonna say it's real.
Wrong again, Brian Rushman.
God damn it!
How's your shoot now?
Damn, dog. All right. Number four.
How come your sideburns don't go all the way down to your beard? I guess that's where you hit all your trivia knowledge.
He shaved off her. It turns out I'm the Samson of Mikey's quizzes.
He's only in the beard connectors.
All unimportant trivia is kept in the mutton chop portion of the face.
And he cut it off, and I've lost my ability.
All right. Number four, starting with Jummy.
Jody.
Time Rider, The Adventures of Lyle Swan. That's the title. An officially dead cop is trained to become an extraordinarily unique assassin in service of the U.S. president. Lyle, a motorcycle champion, is traveling the Mexican desert when he finds himself in the action radius of a time machine, so he finds himself one century back in the past between thieves and murderers.
Thieves is, how's thieves spelled?
Thieves, not thieves.
Okay, it's just Z and one exclamation point.
Got it.
And what was the title
there's
again?
There's actually a four in there? Yeah.
What was the title again?
Time Rider, colon, The Adventure of Lyle Swan.
Time Writer or
Time Writer, like I'm writing
like
a, time.
Like, okay, gotcha.
Like it's a horse. Like all time right, is a right. horse in this hypothetical.
So. I'm going to say it's true.
Okay.
I swear I'm not doing this tactically, but I say it's true.
This is the first one that's actually confused me. Because this sounds... Am I allowed to go into process a little bit?
Yep, yep, absolutely. Absolutely.
This sounds a little bit like there was a period in the late 80s to early 90s where a lot of bad television pilots were released as films.
Movies. Yeah, or direct-to-video
films.
I liked your thought process.
Full Moon would put them out, or like Anchor Bay would put them out, or they would be on syndicated TV. You'd see them on WGN. And this sounds like it could be the pilot episode of Time Rider.
Of Time Rider.
That's why I'm a little confused by this. However, however, it's just so garbage.
Yeah.
It's just so garbage. And the plot is just a little too disconnected from the title.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to go false.
So you go false, and we both went true.
I never go false. Right. This is where you and I part ways.
Indeed. We're going
to
find out.
We have to do it.
Hold on. Real quick.
What do we do?
Okay. Well, also, I factually know the answer to this one.
You do?
Because I fucking loved this movie when
no!
I was in second grade. This dude goes back to the Old West, and it really is. He's riding his motorcycle along.
Really?
And there's an experiment happening, and it is super disjointed. And suddenly, and I'm like, is he a hero? Is he? Because he's just kind of riding around a motorcycle in the Old West. And then meanwhile, like, there was one scene that always creeped me out.
That's a bummer. My original gut was true, and I went false.
I went false.
And now right. And now you're in the lead.
All right. Hey, Mikey, you're back from the bathroom.
I went false.
I revealed that I knew this one was true because it was one of my favorite movies on HBO when I was in second grade.
I was hoping somebody said, it is more mother. It is real. It is real.
And in Andy's defense...
I went true. I went real.
So 2 points to you guys, and you got boned.
Wow.
Have you watched this movie, Mikey?
No.
Oh, man, there's this creepy-ass scene. And, down there. That, like, it was the first time I'd ever seen somebody strip a dead body for clothing.
Huh.
Right, so anyway.
But not the last.
Thank
just
you for that
first.
Fact.
All right.
We are now on you starting.
Right.
Guys, go ahead. Yeah. Number five. Is this a real 1980s action movie or not? The title is Thrill Kill, all one word. And the description is as follows. Carly Kendall's job is to write computer games, but in her spare time, she hacks bank accounts. With $5 million gathered, she wants to retire to Brazil, unaware that her secret partner, Adrian, intends to keep all the money. Moreover, Carly's boss, Julian, has got to know of her doing and has hired villains to get hold of the treasure. Only after Carly's death, they realize that she had hidden the money well inside the computer game Thrill Kill.
Brian?
I mean, it sounds like it's so on the nose, it can't possibly be true. But I want to say it's true because I feel like I remember the name Thrill Kill. But then again, that's the way this sucker works, right? Is that he takes it, but I feel like the memory is strong enough and that it's not a false memory that I'm going to say it's real.
So... Thrill Kill does sound familiar, but that's because there was originally a game for the PlayStation that was called Thrill Kill that came back as the Wu-Tang fighting game. But...
I think that might be what I was remembering.
But I also believe
what
that I remember...
deep dig!
But I also believe that I remember this movie. I also believe that I've seen this movie, and so I'm going to say true.
Okay. Two truths?
Oh, the tactics. Do you agree, or do you separate yourself?
One of us always tells the truth.
Yeah.
One of us always lies.
One of us always talks about how famous he is.
I am also going to say...
Don't let us peer pressure you.
This is true.
We don't need a fucking life story. Just pick an answer.
When I was young, my father made computer games.
It's true. I was a young boy in the convent. The nuns showed me thrill kill. I don't know why.
All right. He says it's true. Yes.
All
true.
Correct.
I mean, I remember that movie because I remember being a kid and wanting it to be more about the video game.
You guys are doing very good, I think. What is the current score? 5-5.
Come on up, Tess.
Jody. Everybody, big round of applause for Tess.
Has 4, and Brian, the man, has 2.
Ah, God damn.
The Samson.
I should have went with my gun on
how
my
floor. How am I supposed to win when I've been lobotomized? All my knowledge, all my skills. I'm like Superman when his powers got taken away.
I don't know if that ever happened.
Superman 2.
Yeah, I'm like that.
Our next movie is Superman 2.
Superman 3 would actually fit really well into this quiz. Richard Pryor is a bank robber. And there's a lady who's a robot.
Slow down. Don't spoil it. All right. Number 6 going to Brian?
No.
To me, I think.
No, Anthony, sorry. Going to Anthony. The title of the film, Mr. Spangles. And the description from IMDb, the most decorated patriot in U.S. Marine history has just been dishonorably discharged for a crime he didn't do.
No,
he didn't do.
Taking on the persona of Mr. Spangles, he will exact America's righteous fury on those in the corrupt government that have wronged him, and there just might be fireworks. Mrs. Spangles.
False.
All in. You're trying to poker face me, and the only answer is all in.
The only question is, what is the true identity of Mr. Spangles? Show yourself, Mr.
Where
Spangles!
Where is Mr. Spangles?
Spangles! The only question is this just
please, Mr. Spangles was my father.
Call me Jim.
Call me Jim Spangles.
My first name is Bo.
So we have a false and a true.
Mr. Bo Spangles.
No. False. So here's the problem. Is everything in my being says it's too perfect, it must be true. But what I'm really saying, if I reframe that, is Mikey couldn't write something this perfect, which I know is not true, so I'm gonna go false as well, because I totally believe you could write something this perfect.
What a breakdown, you are correct.
Yeah!
There's gonna be fireworks. It was too. Yeah. You couldn't resist.
That is correct.
That was the one thing I was thinking of. This is too fun.
Yeah.
This is too fun, and he had fun doing it. I can smell your joy, motherfucker.
Well, next one's going to you.
Let's go.
So tuck in your shirt. The next film is Kajak. And I will spell that.
Yeah, thank you.
The film is in all uppercase K A hyphen J A C K E D exclamation point.
With a slam.
Kajacked! Sergeant Terrell.
We're seeing as a genie.
Excuse me.
I remember this one.
Hashtag Mandela effect. So the description of Kajacked. Sergeant Terrell Justice wants justice, and he wants it yesterday. You did? This is very serious. A drug kingpin is poisoning the streets of the city's hometown with his drugs. Only one cop can stop him, even if it costs him his job again.
Again.
Coming soon. For those who jive enough.
Those who what?
Jive enough.
Those who jive enough.
That's true.
Wait, is it to you?
To me, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
Kajacked! I feel like, and I'm doing this entirely because it seems unlikely that you would do two perfect Mikey fakes in a row.
You can't do that. This is where you get sucked into his game.
hey, hold on. I think my hair is growing back on my sideburns. I'm gonna say that this is another fake, and that this is he did two in a row because it felt unlikely.
Yeah, I'm going false on Kajat.
Oh, it's true.
False.
It was fake.
Yeah!
Tied yet again.
Yeah. Whoa!
Grow, sideburns, grow!
Number 8, going to Brian. Your film is Steel Scorpion.
All right.
This is my favorite description of all time. After his supermodel wife is killed on their wedding day, the Steel Scorpion, but you know him better as Bam Bam Bigelow, takes to the screen as the hottest new action star since Schwarzenegger. Can Steel Scorpion save the United States from a diabolical Russian plot before the clock runs out?
All right. It's not your poker face I'm worried about. It's the co-host of 1-900 Wrestling.
Yeah, that's the thing, right?
We both gotta read Justin on this one. I'm gonna say it's real. It's gotta be real.
I'm saying true.
Hulk Hogan was an action hero. Roddy Piper was an action hero. Bam Bam Bigelow is really, really fat. I'm going to say this is false. You are correct.
Damn it!
I thought, like, because my question was, when Bam Bam Bigelow shows up, will they buy it?
No, like, see, that's the thing, is I have no memory of Bam Bam Bigelow.
Wait, what a screw
I wanted
job.
You to remember the name, not the body?
Yeah.
What a screw job that I had to go first.
Are you a perfect scorer right now?
No, I lost the one.
You missed one?
I missed the one, yeah.
Okay.
Wait, and coincidentally has all his sideburns.
Oh, look away those sideburns that beard connect.
We are down to the last two.
All right.
We are going to Anthony Carbonzo over here. Number nine.
Walk
like a man. As a baby, Bobo gets separated from his family during a camping trip.
Sorry, what was your name?
Bobo.
Okay.
Bobo gets separated from his family during a camping trip. After being raised by wild dogs for 20 years, Bobo is discovered by animal researcher Penny, who brings him back to the family and attempts to teach Bobo how to readjust to life with humans. While his mother is overjoyed to see him again, Bobo's older brother, Henry, is more worried about losing a share of the inheritance. As Bobo progresses with Penny's lessons, Henry plots to have him eliminated. Real or fake?
True.
Not only is it true, but it starred Howie Mandel.
And technically, I was going to say, it does not belong on this quiz because it's not really an action movie.
It's not an action movie.
Not an action movie.
IMDb said it was.
It's a comedy. Doesn't belong on this list. Yeah, he is!
Which, by the way, I don't think it's a secret anymore, but there was a time that I got talked into showing up on America's Got Talent, and I did a...
Jesus Christ!
He had this thing with croutons. He wanted to put them in. It was weird.
Okay, but it was weird because he couldn't touch the croutons or you.
Okay, so he had a tiny little salad.
Caesar salad.
Yeah.
I don't know if he did like Caesar salad. Hold on, trust me on this one. So I did a trick that was, it was the same gag, it was the knife gag that I did on The Tonight Show.
Jesus Christ!
Would you have to stand?
I'm sorry, Carson wasn't here. I gotta fill the void.
So anyway, maybe the king died when I told him this one.
No, I did this quiz on The Tonight Show.
Alright, no,
what
but,
a
so,
dick.
I don't think I've ever told this story publicly, by the way. So I did that.
Which one, about being on The Tonight Show or about being on America's Got Talent? Because you told them both.
Yeah, one of those.
So I turned to Reagan and I say, can you believe it?
So I
said, Reagan, tear down that wall. And he did?
So I did the fake hand staff thing.
Yeah.
And it didn't go over well because everybody actually believed I screwed up and stabbed myself with the thing, including the hosts, who immediately buzzed or whatever. And so then they brought me back out and I realized this didn't go according to plan. It's not gonna work. I know how well the television works. I need to, starting now, make everything unusable. And so, in front of an audience of 600 people, I start lecturing and whatever, like with long, drawn out, no breaks for any edits or anything like that. And it comes down to Howie Mandel, whether or not I'm gonna go on. And then he says no. And then I thought, whatever, you were Bobo.
Oh yeah.
It's a long tail on that kite, Brushwood. Yeah. I'm sorry.
So anyway, here's the story about how I was on Seventh Heaven, where I had a realization that I had a sandwich for lunch.
So anyway, and I've never told this story, but I was watching Bobby's World,
which I was an actor at the time. All right, number 10.
The last one.
Going to Jimmy. Here we go. Number 10.
Jimmy.
So if I get this right, it's over. Otherwise, we tie.
Yeah. Just to see what's going to happen.
This is it.
It's strategic. He's just one ahead. I gotta go opposite him.
The title is The Serpent and the Rainbow. And the synopsis, in 1985, after successful research in Amazonas, Dr. Dennis Allen from Harvard is invited by the president of a Boston pharmaceutics industry, Andrew Cassidy, to travel to Haiti to investigate the case of a man named Christophe that died in 1978 is apparently returned to life. Andrew wants samples of the voodoo drug that was used in Christophe to test with the intention of producing a powerful anesthetic. Dr. Allen travels to meet Dr. Mario Duchamp that is treating Christophe and arrives in Haiti to fear of revolution. Soon, Allen is threatened by the chief of the feared, Tonton McCuse Darjet Trout. Who is a torturer and powerful witch? Alan learns that death is not the end in the beginning of his journey to hell.
True. What's the story? You guys tied?
No.
No.
He's one ahead of me.
He would tie me if we go opposite.
Well, okay.
You have no shot of winning.
Right.
You left your shot of winning on that barbershop floor.
When I had a shot.
You know who else didn't have a shot of winning? Him on America's Got Talent.
Oh!
You got that done! Shit!
Yeah!
You know what?
Who's Bobo now? Stone
Hill Hill just came to Frog Town. Are we just doing callbacks?
Wait, so if you guys are
on the gates,
if you guys are both right, then
he'll win.
Okay, well, let me ensure that happens by saying, yes, it was an HBO original.
No, it was a good movie. Yeah. There's some Red Graves in it.
Yeah.
Oddly enough, it was Wes Craven's first film.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, it was good.
It just sat in the bowl and then became an HBO original in the late.
I should have went with my gut! I should have went with my gut on Lyle fucking Swan! Right?
Right?
Tess?
Right?
All right. Let's bring everybody around.
Most gracious winner, after already saying that he won. Let's take a moment, a good 3 or 4 minutes, to hear the results.
Yeah, you're already insufferable
with your majestic sideburns.
So, Brian has 6, Brian has 8, and Chubby has a plus
29.
Wow!
Nicely done, sir.
Yeah, man.
Return to form.
Dude, let's have a round of applause for Mikey Newman.
Mikey Newman, Mikey's
that was a good one, man.
Always the best.
That was a solid quiz.
Hey,
solid quiz.
I just got an alert on my smartwatch that says 3 minutes ago, live attack, not a live night attack San Antonio, question mark?
Let's also take this time to remind everybody that patreon.com/nightattack is where you can support this show. How many patrons do you have
for nightattack? Doing amazing.
Thank you guys so much. You're the ones who make this happen. Of course,
let's talk.
I don't know. I can
tell.
Okay.
No.
Wow. But we'll have it up as an episode of the show.
Okay, perfect.
I said it shitty, but... No is the answer.
Yeah.
No is the correct answer.
All right, Mikey Newman.
Mikey Newman, I'm also on the Star Wars show. I'm all the Star Wars boys.
Super famous.
He spends most of his days as Chopper.
He's the Force ghost that helps me make my every decision.
Little known fact, I played Anakin Skywalker's hands in the Phantom Menace. Just the hands.
That's good.
So, you can check me out at moviesofmikey.com, check out my show, and I am also doing a live version of my show in a better theater with more people. That is being streamed live on Twitch.
Well, I thought he meant in this right now.
I'm in the Falcon Theater, 6:30 on Saturday, but you can check me out at twitch.tv. Just go to the Pin Your Arcade stream or the Pack stream.
The other thing I love about you the most, Mikey, is that on your D&D character sheet, you've maxed out both anxiety and arrogance. Like, and both of them are at their
can
end.
Can I be honest?
It's nothing but preemptive attacks with this guy.
That both might be the most accurate statement anyone has ever made about me. Cause like, I'm like, yeah, I can use a sword, and then like look at attack and it's like a question mark. Yeah. I don't know how to do anything.
It's like, I'm feeling uncomfortable. Sure, let's launch the bombs.
Yeah.
All of them. All the bombs at once.
Hey man, so can we tease the fact that there's a reason that we're doing this night attack on Thursday of the week before, only 48 hours after the first night attack?
So let's say that theoretically we are going on a shoot!
Okay, alright.
I want to hear about any shoot you're going on, but I'm maxed out on Brian's shoot. So if you can tell us what's going on and Brian can keep his mouth shut.
I should say, theoretically, there might have been a lot of awesome videos that came out last year. In which you were able to see Brian and I do a bunch of fun adventures. We're going to be doing a lot more of those that should be coming out this year. We're going
on vacation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, what if you guys made a TV show and only Brian was in it?
I mean, actually, you have no idea how close to factually accurate that is with my show hacking the system.
Oh, no.
Shut up! This has been Night Attack. Thank you, everyone. I'm shutting it down.
Periscope, I think. Oh, yeah, not to my age.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So, yeah.
I don't have
watching. Man, I'm glad it's over. Like, I had this with the San Francisco show, where I wasn't worried about, like, getting it done, because it's pretty simple, right? It was more like setting up and making sure we had everything we need. And we ended up, like, perfectly prepared, and the show went off pretty well. Mikey's quiz was great. The guys and their, you know, bullshitting was but yeah, and if you're watching, if you are watching, this episode will go up in a few days. I'm gonna get, I need some time to process it. And then the next episode will be February 7th. Right, February 7th, the guys will be in, oh wait, I don't, the guys will be somewhere with a million cameras on them, so. We'll see you guys then. I hope you guys had a really good show. Let us hit me up on the Night Attack show Twitter or my own Twitter or whatever. And yeah.